Prabhupada Dhimahi Dhiyo Yo Na Prachodaya. May we meditate on that Supreme Being who dwells in the hearts of all beings. He is the source and sustenance of this universe. In Him we live, move, and have our being. May He illumine our hearts, and may He guide us in every way. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Peace, peace, peace. I am going to begin a new book, Srimad Bhagavatam. But I must explain to you what kind of a scripture this Bhagavatam is. In India, we have many scriptures. The main scriptures are known as the Vedas. The Upanishads form part of the Vedas. And the Vedas are regarded as the revealed scriptures. They are the most authoritative scriptures. Then we have the Smritis, the Puranas, the Itihasas, and the Tantras. Now all these are regarded as secondary scriptures. Their authority is only based upon the authority of the Vedas. If these scriptures, these secondary scriptures, contradict any truth that we find in the Vedas or the Upanishads, then such will not be accepted as authoritative. The final authority rests upon the Upanishads. Now, let me explain to you what the secondary scriptures are. By revealed scriptures, first let me point out, by revealed scriptures, what is meant is that they are direct revelation of God. The words even, the language that we find in the Upanishads are not composed by men. That is the belief. They are seen and heard. That is why Sanskrit language is called the language of the gods. They hear the truth. And then they jot that down. And that's what we find in the Upanishads. Then there are the Smritis. Or all these other scriptures are written by sages and seers. The Upanishads are not written by sages and seers. Sages and seers recorded them. That is why we find no author's name given in the Upanishads. Only sometimes we find that this truth was given to such and such a sage or seer. So it is not even, the language is not even composed by the sage or seer. That is the belief. Then, the Smritis. Smritis are laws for the guidance of mankind, mostly social laws. But of course, all laws in India, social or ethical or political, all these are based upon spirituality. They are aids and helps to the attainment of the spiritual goal. And so we find smritis, the laws given, say, by Manu. You see, Manu was a great sage. Now, by the way, again, let me tell you another point. As long as I said the Upanishads are not composed by human beings, the first Sanskrit composition began what we call in Ramayana. You know, there are two great epics. These are called itihasas. We call history. Itihasa means history. They are history of the doings of Rama, Ramayana, of the great divine incarnation Rama. And Mahabharata is the record of the doings of the great incarnation Sri Krishna. And these are regarded as histories. And the first Sanskrit language that was composed by a human being is the epic Ramayana. Now there again, if you are not tired, I can tell you a very interesting story. There was a highway robber, and he used to hold up people and sometimes kill them and get all the wealth, as they do in Hollywood also. Yeah, we were about to be held up the other night. I would let that go. And a great sage was passing by. And of course, this robber didn't recognize that he was a sage. And he went to hold him up. Then this sage told him, "Now, why do you do this?" He said, "I have to make my living. I can't get any job. And this is the easiest way to make my living." Then this sage said, "But do you realize that you are creating bad karmas for yourself, and you'll have to suffer for that?" He said, "But I don't suffer alone. I have my mother, I have my wife, I have my children, I support all these people, and they will share my bad karmas." Then this sage said, "All right. You go back home and you tie me on a tree. I won't run away. But you go back and ask your mother and wife and children if they would share your bad karmas." So he went back and tied this sage round a tree. And he asked his mother. The mother said, "But why should I? I don't know how you make your money. It is your duty to support me. And why should I share your bad karmas?" And the same answer was given by the wife and the children. So he came back to the sage and said, "You are right. So I give up. I want to renounce everything. I want to devote myself to God." Then he gave him a mantra. And then he began to repeat the mantra and meditate upon God. And the story is that he was so absorbed in his meditation that, I forget the English word, Anthill grew around him. He was so unconscious of his surroundings. And so he became known as the Anthill sage, you see, Valmiki. Then one day this sage went for a bath in the river, and on a tree, he saw two birds singing happily and enjoying the company of each other. And a hunter killed the male bird. And then the female bird was sorrowful and went round and round this dead body of the bird. And as this sage saw, this anthill sage saw that, there came out a verse from his lips, which means that, O hunter, you could not even resist killing these songbirds who were enjoying their life. Shame on you. And as this came out, it came out in verse, in Sanskrit. And then from deep within himself, a voice he heard. And the voice was, you must write in this particular rhythm the life of Rama. And so he wrote the Ramayana in that particular rhythm. That's how the first Sanskrit language began. Now, of course, this is not within our subject. We went away from the subject a little. Then, now, the Smritis are the laws, and the lawgivers are the seers and saints and sages. And the idea is that those laws, if one follows, through them, through such social and ethical laws, one would reach the spiritual ideal. But of course, the Smritis, or these laws again, change in different ages. What we find in the Upanishads is the eternal truth, that never changes. But the Smriti, the lawgivers, are many. And according to the conditions of the age and time, the laws also change. They are not eternal laws. Then there are the Puranas. The Puranas also were written by sages and seers, and they were written in order to explain the abstract truths of the Upanishads. You see, Bhagavatam is a Purana. And it has been written by the great seer Vyasa to explain in a popular way with stories and parables, and giving the life examples of great teachers and incarnations to expound the abstruse truth that we find in the Upanishads. And then come the Tantras. The Tantras give us the practical disciplines and methods by which the truth that we find in the Upanishads can be experienced. So Tantras are the practical aspects of religion. And Puranas give us teachings in a popular form, explaining the abstract truths of the Upanishads. So these are the different scriptures we have in India. But as I said, if the Puranas or the Itihasas or Smritis, any of these secondary scriptures contradict any truth of the Upanishads, then we discard that. Now there are 18 Puranas, and Bhagavatam, what we are going to study, is the most important of all these 18 Puranas. And we shall not begin from the beginning, because you can get a book. Now, I am not trying to sell my book. But you can get a book and read all the stories. They are interesting stories. Even the children can understand and follow them. In fact, you know, in India, children are told stories from the Bhagavatam, from the Ramayana, from the Mahabharata. The stories are told to the children. And many dramas and operas are written based upon the stories of the Puranas. I remember when a little boy, I went with my grandfather to see a theater for the first time. And there was a story from the Bhagavatam. Now I won't go into that story. It is very interesting, you'll find in the Bhagavatam, the story of Prahlada, a young boy, how he realized God. We shall begin, now of course this Bhagavatam, first few books, it gives many stories of many saints and sages and how they realize God. And then in the 10th book we find the life of Sri Krishna. Sri Krishna is a divine incarnation, regarded as God incarnated in human form. And then in the 11th book, which we are going to study, contains the teachings of Sri Krishna to one of his beloved disciples, Uddhava. You know, you have all read the Gita, Bhagavad Gita. I'm sure you have read it. And there you find Sri Krishna, the same Krishna, is teaching another of his disciples, Arjuna. And here we find the disciple is Uddhava. Now again, before we can understand the very first chapter of the 11th book, I'll have to explain to you a little background. Sri Krishna is regarded as a divine incarnation. Now, as I have many times explained to you what incarnation means, and there are two great religions of the world which believe in this divine incarnation, Christianity and Hinduism. With this difference that Christianity accepts Christ as the one and only one, whereas in Hinduism we regard there are many divine incarnations that had come previously and there will be many incarnations coming in future. And in the Puranas, you know how it is brought out, when the divine incarnation is born. As I said, the Puranas are written in a popular form to bring out that abstract truth. Now, the abstract truth that we find is this, that whenever the time needs it, and what is that time? When there is a greater predominance of evil, and the truth or righteousness has become forgotten. You see, you have the Upanishads, you have the Bible, you have the scriptures of the world. But they are just books. No exemplar. And people do not, they read and read the Bible, they read the Vedas, but they don't get the spirit of the scriptures. And even though they are very simple truths, they will say, oh, this is not for me, or this is not practical. As you find many Christians, what devout Christians will tell you, oh, that Sermon on the Mount, that's not practical. Or what Christ had taught you, turn the other cheek when somebody slaps you, That's not practical. You see? So the spirit becomes forgotten. And when the spirit becomes forgotten, there is the predominance of evil. And then is it that God incarnates. And this happens from time to time. As Swami Vivekananda explained it this way, that a wave rises, then again it falls down. Again this wave rises. No civilization moves in a straight line. No culture moves in a straight line. There are ups and downs. Empires rise and empires fall. Nations rise and nations fall. But that is not the end. The nations fall again to rise once more. And third time to fall again. That's how civilization goes. That's how nations go. Same with spirituality. There is the predominance of spirituality in one age. It goes down again. And when it goes down, there comes a great teacher. And this great teacher we call divine incarnation. Now in the Puranas, how this truth is brought out in a very simple way. The earth, Mother Earth is complaining that she cannot bear the weight of sin and evil. So she appeals to the gods in heaven. And the gods in heaven also feel sad for mankind, for their evil ways. So the gods go to the God of gods and say, Lord, wake up from your samadhi. There is a crying need on earth for you to come down. And so he comes down, being prayed by these sages and seers and by gods. Hearing their prayer, his heart moves, God's heart moves, and he comes down as man. Now again, the same gods, when God in human form, the avatar or the divine incarnation, has lived and has established righteousness, has shown the example, has become the embodiment of the eternal truth. Then again gods come down and pray to him, Lord, come back to our heaven. It is time. And so he says, all right, I'm ready. And so this chapter that we are going to read, the first chapter in the 11th book, it is just that gods have come to tell Sri Krishna that it is time that he must leave this earth. Now, as we read the prayer, you will find that there is a wonderful truth contained in the prayer. And the truth is this. Generally, you find anybody at first thought could not accept God in human form. It is but natural. You see, your mind will revolt. Why should I worship a man? You see, if you are asked to worship Christ as God, you'd say, Christ is a man. Why should I worship a man? And the answer is that no, you must not worship man. If you consider Christ as a man, do not worship him. If you consider Krishna as a mere man, do not worship him. You must worship God and God alone. Now, when anybody worships a divine incarnation, a Krishna or a Christ, he does not worship the man. He worships in him God. God who is the creator, the preserver, and in whom this universe dissolves. God who is with form and without form, who is personal and who is impersonal. You see, that God they worship in Krishna or Christ. If you cannot, do not worship man. In Christianity also, as I told one Sunday, I explained to you, that this in Christianity you have this idea of Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And if you worship Christ as a historical man, Son of God, no, you are not worshipping God. But if you see in the Son of God, Father and Holy Ghost, that is the impersonal God, Brahman, and Holy Ghost, the Atman within, is your very self. If you can worship Christ as this unity in the Trinity, then only you can worship Christ. And the same idea is in the worship of any divine incarnation. And then again you will find that in this prayer, you see, it is not that they are asking that everybody must worship Krishna. The gods are praying to Krishna. But as they are praying to Krishna, they point out how whoever is worshipping in whatever way, they are worshipping you. You see the idea? They do not say you must worship God only in this form as Krishna. But worship God. And if you worship God, then to a devotee of Krishna, you are worshipping Krishna. To a devotee of Christ, even as you are worshipping Krishna, you are worshipping Christ. If you are a devotee of Christ, that is, if you worship God in Christ, not man Christ, then whoever is worshipping God in any form is worshipping your beloved Christ. You see the whole idea behind? One time, I'll tell you this incident in this connection. One time, some Christian missionaries in India were preaching in front of a temple. And of course the priests didn't like that. One of the disciples of Ramakrishna, as he saw, he acted on his first impulse. He began to chant the name of the Lord. And he asked everybody to chant the name of the Lord. And the whole crowd chanted the name of the Lord. And so this poor missionary couldn't preach. The meeting broke. And then, as this disciple of Ramakrishna did, he felt very sad. He began to think, oh, why did I do that? I should not have acted that way. And then he had the vision of Ramakrishna. Ramakrishna appeared to him in vision and scolded him. Why did you do that? You must go and apologize to that man. Don't you realize that he was also preaching me? You see, Ramakrishna told his disciple, when this Christian missionary was preaching Christ, he said, don't you realize that he was preaching only me? So no matter how or in whatever way or in whatever form you worship God, everybody is worshiping this one and the same God. Now I'll have no time to read the book tonight. Now may I invite questions? Yes, you see, what he means is this. Then you really understand what religion means. You see, until then, we are struggling to get religion. Religion means realization, means experience of God. So when you have the experience of God, then only you understand what religion means. And then, from that point, your spiritual life, you enjoy.
And the means becomes the end.
Eh?
The means becomes the end. And the way you're knowing God, and that becomes...
No, after you realize God, then you understand what spiritual life means, what religion means. Until then, we are struggling to find religion.
I don't know if I can put this very clearly, but in the verse it says,
No, that is not the Atman. Well, you see, there are two or double personality, as it were, in every one of us. Higher mind and lower mind. And so the higher mind says you must not do it and you should not have done it. But the lower mind, guided by the propensities and impulses, goes and does it. And then you say, why did I do it? That is not the Atman. Atman is not concerned about the actions or thoughts. But Atman is the source, the witness, the pure consciousness, with the power of whose light of consciousness the mind and the ego become conscious and can act and think. But the Atman is not taking note of the good or evil. That's why it says the Lord also, God does not take into consideration the good and bad deeds of people. He is not punishing or rewarding. But the karmas by themselves bring reward and punishment. God is the witness. He is waiting for everybody to come back to Him. And He has love, equal love, for the good or the bad. You see, for instance, a mother. Does the mother give up the wicked child? Mother cannot. Anybody else could give up, but not mother. And you see this idea in Christian theology of God punishing, and you go to eternal punishment. That is all nonsense. Even the earthly mother would not send his son, send her son to eternal punishment. Yes, she would punish sometimes, yes, but not eternally. And so can you think of the heavenly father or heavenly mother doing that? You see, they think that if you can instill fear into the minds of people, they will be good. But that is all nonsense. And then, of course, you go and make a confession and you are absolved. Oh, confession is good for this soul. I am not against confession. Sure, if you can worship God as God, go ahead and do the worship. We cannot even conceive beyond all conception in His true being, in His true reality. But don't you see, there is the presence of God everywhere. So if you worship this as God, you will realize God. This is what you call a material object. Even that, if you worship as God, you will realize God. We have a saying in our country, it's a husking machine. You see, everybody is kicking at it all the time. And so it says that even if you can worship the husking machine as God, you will realize God. And in a divine incarnation, or in a saint or a seer, there is the greatest manifestation of that. But if you worship this as metal, no. Or if you worship a divine incarnation as man, no, nothing will happen. But you know there is the Brahman or God everywhere. That much conception you can have. And then everybody has some ideal of Godhead, some conception, some idea. What I mean is this, that your idea and conception is not the reality, but you are conceiving the reality in your own way. But that is only your reading of that impersonal abstract truth. And so of course everybody can conceive God, conceive of God. Surely everybody is doing that and follow it. That will lead you to the highest, beyond which, who is beyond all conception and beyond all thought. Yes, God speaks. How? Talk to God. You can talk to God. Those are matters of experience, you see. You see, what is reasoning? With our brain we try to reason out things. But there are certain facts that we have to know before we can reason out. And there is no question with regard to the facts, then we don't have to reason, because facts are facts. And so whether one can talk to God or God can talk to us is a matter of experience. If I say yes or no would not make any difference. But there have been great seers and sages who are not lying, I know. That much I can say. And they say, yes, I have talked to God. I have seen God. I have talked to God. Actually, see, God and Atman again are not separate. Atman has taken the form already. You see, you cannot say that God can do this and not that. You cannot limit God in any shape or form. If you say that Atman is only formless, can never assume any form, you are limiting the Atman. You are limiting God. See, there is one truth that Ramakrishna emphasized. Never put a limit to the infinite God. Never say God is only this and cannot be that. You see, from one standpoint, God has become all these forms. Is there anything different from Him? Anything apart from Him? God has become this, God has become that, God has assumed all these forms. So how can we say that God cannot take any form? And if these are anything separate or different from God, then these are limiting God, and He is not infinite then. But then again, don't say God is only this and nothing else. There is a saying of Sri Ramakrishna, go to the neighborhood of God, then you will see all contradictions. Somebody asked Sri Ramakrishna that some say God is with form, some say God is without form, some say God is Krishna, some say God is Christ, some say God is cannot take form. What are we to do? Then Sri Ramakrishna's answer was very simple. He said, go to the neighborhood of God. And then you will find that all these are not contradictory. So move towards God. No matter how, in what, with form or without form or any way, move towards Him. But keep no idea in your head that your idea and your conception is the only truth. Then you become bigoted and narrow and you limit God. Just say, well, this is my idea. That's why we have that word, chosen ideal, ishtam. Each individual has an ishtam, you see. And in India, for instance, the husband would not know what is the ishtam of the wife. The wife does not know what is the ishtam of the husband. So there is no argument about it. No, ishta must not change. When you take the ishtam, it is ishtam forever. No, it's just, you know, of course you change your husbands. But, you see, the idea is one beloved and one is enough. And for eternity.
Surely
what? Yes, that's it. The one, the God that you have chosen to worship, that's your God. You do not change. Then you realize you. That what you have been worshipping is the same as everything else. Yes. But then you don't change. I'll give you one instance. You see, we do the worship of Hanuman, you know, Rama's devotee. And Hanuman happened to come to Krishna. And then Krishna said to Radha, you better take the form of Sita and let me take the form of Rama, because Hanuman is coming. He would not bow down to anybody else. And here is the saying of Hanuman. Mannathe Srinathe Janaki Nathe Abheda Paramatmani. Though I know for certain that my beloved, who is the beloved of Sita, is the same as the beloved of Radha. And also though I know that my beloved Rama is the same as the Paramatman, the Atman, in spite of that, my whole love is for the husband of Sita. Rama is my beloved in spite of everything. But I know that Rama is the same as Krishna, same as Brahman, same as Paramatman. Still, my life is Rama. You see, that kind of one-pointed devotion to the ideal is necessary. But at the same time, know that it is your beloved who has become everything. But you worship that and that only.
And then that other thing Rama said,
that again is a different saying from a different standpoint. I was talking about the chosen ideal. But the other is about the relationship. You see, whether it is separate or one or what. So he said, when I consider myself a physical being, then you are the master, I am your servant. When I consider myself as an individual being, then you are the whole, I am your part. But when I consider myself as the Atman, I am one with you. You see, that again, the relationship. Om
Sahana bhavatu, sahanau bhunaktu, sahavirjam karavavahai, tejasvi navadhitamastu, ma vidvishavahai. Om. May Brahman protect us. May he guide us. May he give us strength and right understanding. May we have love for all. May our study bring light unto us. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. Peace, peace.